later, the home became not just a place for living, but a place of production. When the scale of production expanded and the separate units formed a community, the work was taken out of the home. The modern home, as we see today, was born out of necessity, but also the lifestyle and aspiration of people. The home was envisioned as a commodity for a family, where the image of an ideal family of four was pushed. Four was where people left their work behind. Four was poverty, waiting to be passed down to the future generations. Four was where there was a sense of community and a feeling of belonging to something larger than the self. The modern home consisted of the hall, the bedroom, kitchen, and dining and services. If we were to simplify the activities that happened in these spaces, then there would be play, sleep, cook, and eat. But there has been a change in lifestyle and aspiration of people. Families now come in all different forms and sizes. Individuals are more career-oriented and life-dictated by career choices to a large extent. Advancement in technology has led to a greater convenience of working and shopping from home. There's a sense of self and individualism within the family. Means that there are more activities that are now associated with the home. Although there has been a change in the overall way of living, this is not reflected in the housing projects today. All the plans have similar layouts with the same set of functions, no room for flexibility, and similar sizes of rooms. In this case, there is a large main living in tiny area around which the other rooms are laid out in an L shape. Now let's look at three cases and try to understand their aspirations and dreams. Hi, I'm Lakshmi. I'm 27 years old. I live in Dubai with my husband. My job requires me to work from 8 a.m. to 5:30 p.m. and take some work home with me too. In the weekends, I like to go out with my husband, friends, or stay in and have a movie. This is the house. The main spaces in the house is the main entrance hall, the dining area, the living room, the kitchen, balcony, and the bedroom. Lakshmi doesn't prefer having guests over at the house, and thus the home needs to be tailor-made. In the case of the first space, which is the vestibule, there is a need for a more elaborate vestibule. Because since she does not want the living space or the rest of the house to have to accommodate guests, it means that the guests will have to be accommodated in a smaller space like at the entrance, and from where they would retire to the outside or go out to eat. So that there is a need for that space to be provided. And at the same time, there is also a space that needs to be designed for packages to be received, because right now there is a lot of shopping, everything, grocery shopping even is done online in their case. And since they both work, they're not at home most of the time, and therefore they would prefer that there was a space that could accommodate such functions as well. The second space in the room, which is in the house, which is the dining area, in the case of Lakshmi, she does not use the dining area. Instead, they use the dining space as a workspace. The dining is mostly done in the living room in front of the television. And thus the dining space becomes redundant. And it becomes almost a workspace. The other space here associated with the workspace can be the bedroom, which is the most private space. And since the workspace need not be in the main entrance place of the house, has an association with the bedroom or the more private space, and therefore the workspace or that dining area, which is not actually being used in luxury space, can be put near the bedroom or near the private space and used there. The other thing is the living room. Since the guests are not entering the living area, it is a space that only two people use, and therefore it needs to be again tailor-made for in Lakshmi's case, she sees it as a very private function, and not something that she wants other people to be involved in. So in the kitchen, it was only, it will be only her who works. And therefore, the so in this case, the kitchen is opening towards the most public function. And perhaps the kitchen could open into the private corridor, which again gives more privacy to the kitchen. Another thing is that the balcony, which is being generously given there, is not being used most of the time because of the heat and the weather. And so perhaps if there was a kind of system designed to help that case, the balcony could be used throughout the year. So if we draw a J-graph of the existing land, there is a very large non-metered area which exists, and there is no hierarchy, no certain hierarchy. There's no one central space that all the functions go to. It's a very large open area. Whereas the desired home, what she envisions, has a certain private spaces designated, certain walls, and the home becomes very tight and very walled in certain senses. The second case. I'm 38 years old. I live in Mumbai with my husband. I work from 8 a.m. to 6 p.m. and 1-2 days of the week I work from home. In the weekends, I like to host parties at my house or go out with my husband for a quiet day. This is Hina's house. Hina likes to have people out over for food and drinks. She also enjoys decorating the front door and its premises during festivals and so here, in the case of Hina, the entrance space is again not a very elaborate space. And since she likes to have certain decorations and she likes to hold the space around her house on the outside, it would be good if that area was treated in a certain way and given like a veranda so that it becomes, so that she gets more ownership of the space outside her house. As mentioned before, Hina likes hosting social gatherings. Thus, the living room and the extended balcony becomes a very important space in the house. Further, she likes to have a sense of community and friendship. And therefore, the shared, the balcony that comes up, which will be a larger balcony, is preferred for her to be shared with another unit. So that there is a sense of friendship and community that gets created between those two. Since they live away from their parents, there is a requirement for an extra bedroom which is used by her mom when she comes to home visits. But since that visit is not often, the bedroom, the guest bedroom, becomes almost a dead space for most of the time. And again, tying back to the fact that she likes to have a larger living space so she can host bigger parties, it would make sense that there is a sort of flexibility between the guest bedroom and the living room so that it can be used throughout as a living space, and when the mother visits, then it becomes the guest bedroom. So if you look at the J-graph of the existing home, it has a large non-heated space, but the heated spaces are so far apart, the placement of the space doesn't allow for flexibility. Whereas if there is the flexibility given that the guest bedroom is an open space, then it becomes more flexible in being able to become a larger space, multi-function space. The third case. Hi, I'm Sean, I'm 20 years old from home, studying architecture and architecture. In my free time, I like to work with my friends and play sports. Ishan requires a flexible, well-integrated group. I don't think he requires many walls, as he does not require, another factor is that he does not require a certain, a separate workspace, because he believes that the work and life needs to remain separate. So it has to be a well-integrated house, which is flexible in terms of walls, and therefore which can host the balcony. in his case, acts as a private space. Since the rest of the house would be an integrated space, the balcony would be a completely private space. It becomes a separate addition to the living room as opposed to an extension of the living room. Another aspiration in his case is that one of his main hobbies is cooking, and so he desires that there is a well-designed kitchen with a space that also is an open area which can accommodate other kinds of cooking which can't be done in the closed kitchen. So moving on to what is the way forward, depending on all of these different aspirations and the way that the home needs to change. Do we continue to build houses with similar layouts, dimensions and interrelationships as houses throughout history? How do we as designers draw the line on the number of new housing types that need to come about when we consider the multitude of variations that exist among individuals and families? Any realistic approach to forming new housing types requires a certain amount of generalization that may make the execution reductive in nature. Then, is there something inherently wrong with our houses? So these are the questions that I will.
Like when particular, it should not be something, I don't think if it's flexible throughout the day, it will be used, it will probably just remain, you know, they'll find one layout that works for them best and probably they won't change it throughout the day. But over time, if changes could be made, because say over the years, especially like if it's owned, then they might not they might not keep on moving. If it's a rented space, then according to if there are more people, number of people staying there, you can move to a bigger home or a house that suits you better. But maybe flexible in terms of that accommodates, you know, a larger time period. So, for example, in the case of Lakshmi's case, right now they're a single, I mean, they're a couple. Maybe in a couple of years there might be one kid, then two kids. So then a space that allows for flexibility to happen over the years and not over, I don't think we used it, the flexibility was just throughout the day.
Become the incremental.
Yeah.
So the flexibility converts to incremental. And if these spaces, your family member, your number of people increases in family, now you want to increment or the sort of extend your house outside or maybe add something. But in that space, it becomes flexible. If you want to change the orientation or the layout of the space, it is flexible. But if you want to add something, then it becomes incremental. So what we are talking on urban housing is incremental.
Yeah.
Or walk-up apartments can be incremental. But other than after 3 floors, it's impossible. So what are we talking about?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's difficult to provide for that sort of housing. Yeah.
I mean, there is one project that makes up 77 in Malavika. So like, in the class that the floor bed in the shell is given, the walls are flexible. So,
but I think what he's saying is that it's still that in that particular space, you can't add things to it. So if your family grows, then it still doesn't accommodate for that.
Yeah, actually then that would be like initially itself, you have to buy something. Yeah,
and then it becomes that kitchen you showed, that four kitchens. I think it's an extension.
Yeah.
Sort of extending your space.
And the other was guests or people who come home and then all of you go out together. So you are, they don't actually come in the house. So in both cases, you are talking of an in-between space where you have not actually entered the house, but you are in a secure zone. So I was just thinking, of course, in a non-apartment type, you have, say in Saurashtra, you have the Dela type, or even in Jodhpur or Bangalore houses, you have the door which opens out into the courtyard, which then opens into a veranda, and then you have the room. So in all those kind of housing types, or even for that matter in a contemporary bungalow, you have the front gate which opens into an open space, where you have still not entered the house. Now that one aspect I think is could be generalized as a new need based on the whole idea of online shopping or the whole idea of guests not entering the house. So to me that was one aspect of the kind of things that you're talking about, which is should the conventional type change because times have changed. So when you say that do we continue to build houses with similar layouts, is it that we continue to build house with similar layouts but change the layout? Could be one option. We evolve a new type which is the new conventional type. But then later on you are asking, okay, should there be just one conventional type or should there be multiple conventional? There you are already preempting the problem with that line of thinking by saying that then any type requires you to make generalizations. So if we say instead of one conventional type of house which caters to our conventional imagination of family, let us have 10 conventional types. But then I am only catering to, I am just elaborating into 10 types of families. And if then the argument is no, every family is unique, then that is where you are asking the question, then is mass housing itself a problem?
That is not the issue, it's like there are more problems than we are giving, like trying to give less solutions. Like 100 problems and 2 solutions. But those two solutions might not be applicable in all 100 cases. That is the, like in search of that ideal answer, which plan will be the closest to us.
But the counter argument for that would be, so suppose we say that for every family is unique and therefore what they ideally like is ideally, what would ideally suit them is also unique. Then what we are saying in a way is that suppose there is a family which wants to get their bungalow design. Okay. So as an architect, I know the plan. Are you saying that if that family went to architect A or architect B or architect C or architect D, each one will design a different house for them? Suppose the same family went to Doshi, then Korea, then Kaminde, Anant Rajay and Rajay to design, get the, they will all design different houses for the same family. What does that mean? Would we then argue that only one is right? So can we say that just because all families are unique, the solutions in terms of house has to be, there is a unique solution.
There is only one solution.
It would be difficult to say that. The same family going to 4 different architects will get 4 different plans. That means all 4 plans are working for that family. Which means we cannot argue that if the family changes, the house type also has to change because their demands are new. So in that degree of personalization. Some people argue that everyone's tastes are unique, so in an ideal situation, if you have unlimited options or the option of making changes in my house that is flexible, then it is best. But
But I think it is assuming that there is a ideal for every person or every family, and that if given enough time and enough interaction with the family, as an architect, I can design what is ideal for that family. I think that can also be questioned. Architecture is not a science that I can do an extensive questionnaire of the family and design what is perfect. So some generalization any architecture already does. So then it's just a question of what degree of generalization. I'm not trying to argue that therefore it will work equally well for any of the three or for any type of family. Of course there are variations. But where do we draw the line? There are some people who will say, no, give them complete flexibility, let them design the way they want. That's the best
way. Yeah, it's just putting all the responsibility of having a
professional. Yes. Yes. Yeah, one could also argue that. Then what's your role as a professional?
Yeah, yesterday what we were discussing was the maybe they don't have this, they can just recognize what they want,
right,
in terms of, like, they cannot manifest it out key, okay, this architectural element or this architectural space will help me with my requirement. So, like, where do we draw the line between how much to give and how much to give it for the users?
This is a possibility only in not in mass
person. What if
where the user
there are people who have, I think, some later presentations might talk about that. There are examples of people trying to do in mass housing, give people flexibility.
What if, like in mass housing, almost like usually the product is first made and then people buy it? But what if, you know, people were involved in the design? Say, for example, have five different layouts in the same apartment. So while buying it, people chose what they wanted. Maybe they wanted a duplex, maybe they wanted
But then the next question, what if I have kids? What if kids grow up? So and one is arguing that your needs are not genuine. But then one is also arguing that after 5 years my needs change.
Probably why, like, rented homes are there, it's time for them to, until they decide it's time for them to
sell. Yeah, so I think rental is a good mechanism of saying that you don't purchase so that you're not stuck. You move out and go into some
other. Like the furniture thing is, like, you just have to give them the space, they make the interior of that space. So whenever you want to tweak it, or you want to add some extra table or make a partition, such kind of semi-permanent, semi-temporary furniture system that helps you in some way.
So if we say that the aspirations of the rental spaces are there, so now there could be a question whether it would be the sense of the space or the apartments which you are.
So it also depends on our imagination of rental is that we have rental that we are moving in and moving out. If I look at Bombay, for example, and all the people who are living in these chawls or smaller houses, all of them are technically rented. They pay rent to a landlord. But they have been living in that place for 40 years. So rental does not stop you from permanently living. So some countries, especially in Europe, they primarily follow a rental system where you have a landlord and you are renting out your apartment. Where they rent, so they sign, in Bombay also it is not very but fairly common to sign a long lease. It's in Ahmedabad where the most common form of rental is 11-month contracts, right? No one signs long leases in Ahmedabad. They are worried that the tenant will not move. But Bombay has a system where people are, many of my friends are living on 10-year leases with an option to Of course, you have to give 4 months or 3 months. Both parties have to give 3 months or 4 months warning if they want to ask the other person to move out. But so you can sign an 11-year long lease if you want that sense of, you know, would be the counter to that. Or there might even be some people who are truly nomads in the sense that they don't value that sense of.
There's no need for that sense of belonging.
Yeah. Or their sense of belonging is not tied to the place but to maybe the objects that they have. Maybe their favorite clothes or bed sheets or one center table that they will use, they will shift. If you study people, for example, if you study people who are in the army or who shift, or even bank jobs, public sector bank jobs where you shift every 2 years, they have all a very different set of attachments because they know that they will shift. That's another angle.
I mean, the sense of belonging is not necessary.